Well, my wife Melissa and I have been Salvationists our entire lives. She comes from a big Army family. All of her siblings are Salvation Army officers. Her grandparents are retired Salvation Army officers. She has some aunts and uncles who are retired Salvation Army officers. My mother was introduced to the Salvation Army when I was just a kid, and she fell in love with it. She retired as a social services caseworker, and she took all of her children to church at the Salvation Army. So I was raised as a Sally kid. I was one of those children who did everything at the Corps, participated in all the youth events, went to what we call our youth councils, which is a weekend spiritual retreat for children, or young people, young adults, and in time received my calling to ministry.
Where was that? Where were you growing up?
Virginia. I was born and raised in Northern Virginia. Both my wife and I come from military families. Her dad was career U.S. Marines. My dad was career U.S. Army. So we were both military brats. My dad was, I was the last of three, and I came sort of later in life. My dad was already retired by the time I was born. So I had a very stable life. I grew up in one place in Northern Virginia. She moved around. She's the oldest in her family, so she moved around with her family, her father, as he transferred from post to post. Like I said, we grew up in the Salvation Army as our church home. That's how our first interaction and engagement with the Salvation Army was as our church. That's where we were converted, where we were saved, where we and our faith was nurtured in the Salvation Army. So when we got the call to officership or to ministry, it was, of course, in context of the Salvation Army. And like all most Salvation Army officers, we were approved as candidates, were accepted, just like Rashad. You know that Rashad is going to training this year, and he'll spend 2 years at the Salvation Army's Evangeline Booth College. We spent 2 years starting in 2000, and we were commissioned and ordained in 2002, and we've been serving in the Southern Territory here in the United States for 18 years.
How did you end up in Anderson? How did this come about?
In April of this year, we got a phone call from our divisional commanders in Kentucky and Tennessee. We were serving at the Salvation Army's Center of Hope in Murfreesboro, Tennessee, and we were told that we would be changing appointments, transferring to Anderson, South Carolina. So we had a couple months to get ready, and in June of the 21st, we left Murfreesboro and came here.
And what did you know about Anderson before you came here?
Nothing, actually. It was brand new. Of course, the first thing you do is when you get an appointment to a new city is you Google it. And I got to learn a little bit about the history off of Wikipedia. I understand that you're the Electric City, and you get that moniker because you were one of the earliest, if not the first, in the Southeast to be entirely powered by electricity. So that's an interesting historical tidbit fact. And I love history, so it was nice to read about that. And I was able to look around and see the different the geography and the environment that you have here. You got Lake Hartwell and a number of other really nice features. And so the last time I spent any time in South Carolina was when I spent 3 months at Parris Island in South Carolina. So it's nice to return to South Carolina and get to know and get to serve here.
It's good to be on the other end of the state, not down in the...
That's right. To get away from Parris Island have the freedom of enjoying a nice community is a real treat.
Well, I know you've probably talked to some of the previous officers here. What do you see as the biggest challenges you'll face while you're coming in here?
Well, you have to... Typically, the Army teaches us to spend about a year to really get to know your community before you begin to cast a vision and begin to really establish goals, long-term goals. So we're going to take the year and get to know our community, get to know everybody here, get to know our peer agencies, get to know the needs of this community before we really dig in and try to advance the mission of the Salvation Army. One thing I can say, we will work hard to advance the mission of the Salvation Army, which is to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ and to meet human need in His name without discrimination. We're going to do that, but the exact way that's accomplished in Anderson, we don't know yet. We already have a great ministry here, the Salvation Army, that is, has a great ministry with our shelter program and with the Boys and Girls program. of course, COVID-19 and the pandemic has changed the face of ministry, and what's changed the face of all of our lives, period, let alone the way we conduct business and the way nonprofits are operating. Our Boys and Girls Club has been shut down, and schools have been shut down since the pandemic began. How and we will and when we'll begin to reopen and reestablish those programs and reestablish the connections to our kids and their families, we don't know yet. And that'll be something we'll have to work through and get in place. But we're looking forward to continuing the great ministry the Salvation Army has, and also just advancing it, going deeper in the community, having a more significant impact, and making the Army as open and available to as many people in this community that needs our programs and services as possible. And that's going to take a community effort, everything from fundraising to actually doing the ministry itself and the programs and services. We want to do it right and make sure that we're consistent in the services that we're offering.
What's your favorite part of ministry?
Favorite part of ministry would be getting to know people. One of the neat things about being a Salvation Army officer is the fact that we do get to move to new communities every so often. And just discovering new folks. My wife is a collector of people. And so Melissa, she has a number of folks who we've made family. And that's something that we get to, it's not unique to Salvation Army ministry, but what makes it so unique is the fact that we go from place to place. And we have sort of an eclectic little group of folks who are part of our circle of family. And so that's probably my favorite part, is just being able to rub shoulders with people, get to know so many different people. To get down into the dirt and the mud and work hard with so many different people, different groups, different agencies, and just folks from the community who care about serving others. So just getting to know them, getting to work with them, and building sometimes what turns out to be lifelong relationships. It's a beautiful thing. It's something I enjoy.
As you're getting to know people, what are some of the either misconceptions or just lack of knowledge people have about the Salvation Army and your mission and what all you do?
Well, probably the biggest is they don't realize that our work goes beyond Christmas. That's when the Salvation Army is an iconic part of that season. You cannot watch a Christmas movie without seeing a bell ringer or a Salvation Army band playing. It's just part of our culture. And the fastest way to establish a Christmas scene is to have a bell ringer. And everybody instantly knows that time in the movie or the play or whatever it might be is Christmas time. And so people's concept of the Salvation Army gets trapped into thinking, well, they're good because they help people at Christmas and, they have a thrift store and the like. But as you all know here in Anderson, that the Army has a much greater impact and it's a 365, 24/7 ministry around the world. But here in Anderson, you've got the Salvation Army providing the Boys and Girls Club and all those really rich programs, those life-enriching and academic-enriching programs, athletic-enriching programs. And then, of course, here you have the shelter and the ministry that takes place in those four walls where people go from being dispossessed and homeless to finding a place to call home and finding a community. So, and then we have, many people don't realize, we began our interview, me talking about my wife and I being ordained and commissioned, Salvation Army is a recognized Christian denomination. And as such, my wife and I pastor a small congregation of Salvationists who worship here and grow in their faith as Salvationists and as Christians right here.
Are you doing volunteers now, or right now it's on hold?
Right now, our volunteerism, we are holding off on that and try. Most of our stakeholders in the community are probably getting antsy and really wanting to get back into doing their ministry with the Salvation Army. We have delayed that until we get further, until the restrictions loosen up and everyone is feeling comfortable and safe to be in close proximity with each other. We're having to take those safety precautions. So, yes, the short answer is we're not taking volunteers at the moment.
But in better times, can people now call and say, when it gets better, how can I help? What's the best way for people that want to get involved in helping what y'all are doing here? How can they do that?
Yeah, when we're talking about one-on-one type of ministry or engaging in programs and services, that'll wait a little bit, but there's still many really nice ways of engaging and supporting the Salvation Army. Everything from writing your check, making a donation, to donating food. We are still serving our shelter population, and we still serve folks who come to us needing food. So canned food drive is a great way to support the work of the Salvation Army, as we provide food pantry service and rent utility services and a hot meal at night. So food is a great way to do that. Again, the old check, writing the check and dropping that in the mail and supporting the work of the Salvation Army. Those are probably the two easiest ways, two quickest ways to support the work of the Salvation Army, and prayer. Pray for us as the new leaders that God will give us the wisdom and vision to lead the Army well. We've got a great staff here, and we got a great bunch of volunteers who in time we hope to be able to meet and work hand in hand with them. I recognize that anything that has eternal value is a God thing, and God has to do it. So I do covet everyone's prayers on behalf of my wife and my family. So that we can be the Salvation Army leaders that you need us to be.
And the donations made here, it stays here. People, it's local, stays local, is that correct?
That's correct. That's always true in any Salvation Army effort that you would support. It stays locally. The one exception might be with disaster work, but of course, if you're funding a disaster or a hurricane along the coast, you know that it's going to the folks in South, the affected areas and the like.
And when health restrictions begin to be lifted, people can come down and get a tour of the place and see everything?
Absolutely. One of the neat things that we've done in the past, and there are other appointments, and I'm sure it was done here, like to call them lunch and learns. And we will invite folks, we'll send out an open invitation, and we'll pare it down. It's not meant to be a large event. This is meant to be small and kind of an intimate setting where it's just a few people at a time. But we'll come and have lunch, and you'll learn some stories from folks who the Salvation Army has served and benefited, and their success stories and their hardships, and how the Salvation Army supported them and provided much needed help. And then you'll get a little tour of our facility. You'll see the shelter, and you'll see, or the Boys and Girls Club, whatever program that we're highlighting in that lunch and learn. And so you get a chance to have a up close and personal hour, just getting to know the Army better. Well, to find out more about how you can support the Salvation Army here in Anderson County, you can call the Salvation Army at 864-225-7381 or visit us on Facebook.